God called him to serve as a global mission pioneer in Buolo Village in Manado, Indonesia. This district is considered an unentered area for the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and many people are hungry for the gospel. Larry received approval from government officials and the village leaders to work here. The first thing he did was visit every family in the community to become friends with them. As with many other small islands, most people here work as fishermen. Larry loves to be out on the water with the fishermen, helping them feed their families. He has found that by implementing Christ's method of ministry, people allow him into their daily lives. Planting fruits and vegetables is not common practice in this area. Larry saw this as an opportunity to meet people's needs. He created a farmers group to teach the community how to start small gardens or farms around their houses. The goal was to provide some of their vegetables, chilies, and other daily foods. Larry always starts the programs with worship and prayer. But the farmers group is just one of his methods of outreach. He also helps the community by distributing used clothes to them, which makes them very happy. Since this island is so remote and far from the main island, medical care is hard to access. Malaria is a threat here. High blood pressure and cholesterol are some of the common health challenges. Larry helps out by providing free health checkups and basic medical treatment to community members. People are so grateful for what he is doing for them. One day, one of the farmers' group members was sick. He's one of the members who came regularly to the worship discussions and grew interested in the Sabbath. Larry took care of him until he was fully recovered. The family praised the Lord because of his kindness. This family has asked Larry to continue visiting them to pray and share more about the truth, especially more about the Sabbath. Please pray for the work that Larry is doing in this newly entered area of Indonesia. Pray that more people will open their hearts and be ready for the second coming of Jesus. Thank you for supporting global mission efforts to send pioneers like Larry into unentered areas of the world.
We are going to start off with some praise songs to get our hearts ready, and we're going to start off with a prayer. So if you would care to stand up, we'll pray to start our service. Okay, I'll pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you that all of us are gathered here together, that we all come with the same heart and the same mind, of wanting to know you better, of wanting to thank you for all that you've done for us this week and in our lives. And of course, also to beseech your help for so many different things that we're going through and seeing in our world. So we ask for your presence here today, that everything we do can be for your honor and for your glory, and that we'll feel your spirit among us, leading us and guiding us. And bless everyone that's helping with the service today, that we will do everything in the right way, so that it can be the best blessing for everyone here. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so we're going to start off with the hymn, God Will Make a Way. This one's not from the hymnal, but we'll have the words up here. Thank you. Next up is Great is Thy Faithfulness. If you care to look in your hymnal, this is number 100. Oldie but a goodie. Is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. It's in your hymnal, number 154. If you care to look it up, we're going to do 1, 3, and 4.
Oh,
were a little different. But if you care to have a seat, we're going to now have the children's story with Lonnie Litchfield.
Well, good morning, children. It is good to have all of you here. Today's story is about two children named Andy and Bernard. Now, they were very good children, and their mother, of course, loved them very much, and they loved their mother and father. Well, one Friday, their mother came and said, "Oh, my, I've got so much to do. But Father wants me to go into the city with him." But she said, "I've just got so much to do for the preparation day since Sabbath is tomorrow." How many of y'all have to get things done for Sabbath? I know we try to do things like mow the yard and stuff like that before Sabbath so it looks its best. Well, Andy and Bernard said, "Well, Mother, you go ahead and go with Dad. He will like having you, and I know you like going to the city with him, and we'll take care of everything." And she said, "Are you sure?" She said, "There's mopping to do. There's the dishes to do. The porches need to be swept. The living room needs to be dusted and vacuumed." And they said, "Mom, we've got plenty of time to do all of that. We'll get it done for you. You just go with Dad." And she said, "Okay, you are such wonderful little dears. Are you sure you can get it all done?" They said, "No problem, Mom. You just go have fun." Well, Mom said, "Okay, we'll be back right before sundown, and we'll have worship when we get home." So they went ahead and left, and they waved goodbye. "Well, Bernard, do you think we should start now?" "Well, I've been working on a toy boat, and I'm almost got it done." And then Andy said, "Well, I've been reading a book. I would like to finish that. When do you think we should start?" "Let's start about 2:00. That sounds like a really good time to start." And so they started building their boat and reading their book. Well, 2 o'clock came, and Andy said, "Do you think we ought to start now?" "Yeah, I think this is a good time to start, but I've got just a little bit more of my book to read. Why don't we give me just a few minutes?" At almost 4 o'clock, they went ahead and finally got started. And they put some soap in the water. They didn't have dishwashers then. Kids were the dishwashers. And they started getting the mop bucket out. And all of a sudden, they heard vroom, vroom, vroom. And Tom, next door, had gotten a new little engine. And they thought, wow, that's pretty cool. Well, the engine quit. And all of a sudden, who do you think came to their door? Tom. And he said, "Why don't you come over and help me play with my new engine?" They said, "Well, we've got a lot of work to do." And he said, "It'll just be for a little bit." And so they decided to go. Well, they came back, and it was almost 5 o'clock. But they started doing it again, and all of a sudden, there was a knock on the door again. And it was two more friends, and they said, "We need you to come and play cricket with us." And he said, "We've got so much work to do." They said, "We don't have enough people. Could you do it for just 15 minutes? And they said, "I think if we really hurry, we can get it done if we only stay for 15 minutes. Well, at 6 o'clock, they finally made it back home, and the sun was going down. And they thought, "We've got to get things going. We got to get it going now. We're really going to have to rush." And they said, "Well, I know Mom will want the porches to look good, because if the porch doesn't look good, they're really going to be upset." So they started on the porch, and Andy took the porch in the front, and Bernard took the porch in the back, and they almost had the front porch cleaned off when Mom and Dad drove up in the car. And Mom said, "You haven't got this done yet." And they said, "We're almost done." And she went in the house, and there was the mop bucket still in the kitchen floor, and the dishes still weren't done. And Mom said, "Oh my, we're not going to be ready for Sabbath at all." And they said, "We're so sorry, Mom." And all day Sabbath, they could see the look of disappointment on Mom's face. And she never loved them again. Oh, wait, no. They never disappointed Mom again, because they felt so bad. So always do your work first and then play. All right, go back to your seats.
Well, good morning, everyone. Y'all are sleeping still. That's okay. I just hope you wake up as the service goes along and not going the other way. All right, so I have a few things that I want to share with you this morning. One of them is a possible need. We won't really know until we get there, but Eric, our AV guy back there, he's going to be in Michigan for 3 Sabbaths. And yeah, whoa, exactly. I don't know how much everybody realizes, but Eric does a lot back there. And Carter does a lot, too. He's running the soundboard right now. But Carter has other places that he helps as well. And so he really won't know his full availability until sort of the week of. So there are going to be three Sabbaths that we possibly could need some assistance back there in the AV booth, specifically running the soundboard. And I know that when you look at it and you see all those bright, shiny, blinking lights, it looks very complicated, and it is. But Eric said that if there's anybody who would be willing to touch base with him, hopefully today at the end of the service, that he would be willing to do just a little bit of some basic training and even write out some outlines of exactly what order and what time and when things need to be pushed. And so if there is anybody in here who either you have the heart, you're feeling like, well, maybe God is asking me to go talk to Eric this afternoon, or if you have any prior background with sound or running a soundboard, please, please, please touch base with Eric. Because if we get to those Sabbaths and we don't have somebody back there, then we probably aren't going to be able to live stream. And there are a lot of people that depend upon seeing the live stream. We're not going to be able to record it. And we might not even have the microphones running. Yes, Lonnie. It is August 13, 20, and 27. Is that correct? So it's the second, third, and fourth Sabbath in August. August 13, August 20th, and August 27th. No, you will not be made fun of if you mess up. You can take my word on that. I will be your biggest defender. So maybe, you know, as the service goes on, just be thinking and praying about that. And if God is impressing you, just touch base with Eric after the service. All right. And then also, I just want to give you a little heads up. I know that many of you are aware that I have not been here much lately, but it's not because I've been on vacation. I was in Lexington, Kentucky for the Called Pastors Convention. And then I was two Sabbaths there in Wewoka Woods for camp meeting. But this next weekend, I am going to be on vacation and leading up through this next week. So I just want you to be aware that if you reached out to me or if you emailed me or text me and maybe I'm not responding back, it's because I'm on vacation. And I would encourage you, if there is an emergency, if there is something serious and you need to talk with one of our leaders, reach out to one of our elders, okay? So just a heads up on that. And also just a preview of next Sabbath. Does anybody in here know Micah Modrell? Okay, a few of y'all. He's going to be preaching the sermon next week. He's one of the elders at the Canadian Valley SDA Church, and he's going to be preaching a sermon entitled Lessons from Jericho, the Tax Collector. And he's given me a little bit of a preview, and I think that y'all are going to love it. And then last but definitely not least, I'm looking around Eden. Eden McDonald, could you come forward for just a moment? I mentioned it a few weeks ago, but just for clarification, in case you didn't remember, we had a number of our young people make decisions for Christ at summer camp there at Wewoka Woods. And Eden was one of them, and she got baptized there at the summer camp. And so I wanted to just recognize her and let you all recognize her as well, give you a little gift. And then also, now that you are seeing her, now that she has been baptized, we also need your help, church family. We need to have a vote to invite her into membership here at this local church. So I see a lot of firsts. Do we have a second? All in favor, a hearty amen. Amen. Eden, welcome to the family. Thank you. And then also, I don't want anybody to feel left out. So we're going to get into a little bit more in the sermon, and you're going to see a picture. But Abriana also got baptized at camp meeting. Abriana, it's up to you. Do you want to come up here so everyone can see you, or maybe just stand up where you are? Could you just maybe just stand for just a second, just so that people, or just wave so that people can see who you are. So Abrianna, she also, yes, she made a decision for Christ and she was baptized. I'm not gonna bring her up to vote her into membership yet because I've been talking with her dad, studying with her dad, and we thought that it might be cool at a future date to be able to vote both he and her in together on the same day. All right, I believe that, oh, also, just let me call your attention to the middle page of the bulletin under Church Happenings and under the subheader New Church Positions. Give that a read over. I'm not gonna cover all of it, but just let me remind you, if you are stepping into a new position coming up in September when the new positions take place, and you feel that you need a little training, you feel that you need some resources, you need a little help, you've never served in this area, please, please, please reach out and let us know. Pastor Ellie, he was the nominated committee chair. He'd probably be the best person to reach out to, but you can also connect with me because we want to empower you, offer any training and resources so that you don't feel like you are just on your own. We want to connect you with a mentor and give you some of the training so that when you step into that position come September, you will feel like God has been preparing you for that position.
All right, let's talk about money. Lonnie's favorite subject, right? Everybody, if you have your bulletins, first, we should always give appreciation to the wonderfully intelligent, beautiful human being who puts these together every week. I don't know if you know who that is, but amen. Yes, thank you, sir. Under the stewardship summary, you will see June. Everybody look at that combined budget number. $25,000, that is a huge blessing. Say amen. Now, the challenge is for July that y'all need to do better than that. July is typically our lowest month because of camp meeting and other issues, people taking vacation. We've as a leadership team, we've talked several weeks up here about the financial situation here at the church. You all have responded wonderfully. We thank you for that. You always give what you can give, and you give with a good heart. As long as you do that, God will bless this church as he has always blessed us. So if the deacons will please rise and we'll pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you as we always do for the blessings that you've given us. We are humbled by how you have continued to bless this church and our church members, no matter what the outside world circumstances dictate. We all have been blessed. We have continued to have house and clothing and food. We pray for all those people who don't have those things. As we talk about money for our church building, we can never forget that some of that money that we give goes out to the community and helps those who need it the most. We ask that you continue to bless this church, both financially and especially spiritually. We ask that you dig deep into the hearts of all of us, that we can give what we can and with a willing heart. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath. Good morning. Today's sermon, today's scripture will be Exodus 3:2. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed.
Happy Sabbath. I'm Jeremy. I'm currently here in summer vacation. I go to school in Southwestern Adventist University, so it's a pleasure for me to always play in my home church when I can. So today I'll be playing for a foundation.
Jeremy grew up. I remember there was several years ago some Pathfinder campouts that Jeremy was about that tall and he'd sneak into the cook tent and help me cook for everybody. Today, for the pastoral prayer, we're going to pray for a specific family. Phyllis Hansen, Dave Hansen's mother, fell last week and did some serious injuries to her spine. She has had surgery and she's had some vertebrae fused together and she is moved out of the ICU and she is now resting. She has a long, long road ahead of her for recovery. So today we want to keep not only her, but the whole Hansen family. They're a very tight-knit clan and they're very intertwined within their business and their life. And she's a big part of that. So they're going to have a hard time moving forward. So if y'all would get on your knees if you can, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you gracious and humbled. We pray specifically for Phyllis Hansen as she is dealing with a severe injury and she has a long, hard road recovery ahead of her. We pray for her family that you give them the strength, the courage, the fortitude, and the resources that they're going to need to move forward with this. They are a wonderful family who has blessed this church with their giving, their time, their energy, their leadership. They are going to need all the help that they can get. I would also like to pray for our friend Calvin. Calvin has recently lost somebody very close and dear to him, Jean. He's a wonderful man. She was a wonderful lady. And one of the hardest things I can imagine is losing a lifelong friend, trying to move on from that and keep a positive spirit. But Calvin, your church is behind you and we love you. For the rest of us, whatever it is that we're going through, whatever burdens we have, whatever things that we're dealing with in this incredibly complex and sometimes terrible world, we know that the one constant since the beginning of everything has been our loving God. The one and only thing that we can always count on without fail. It is hard for us to comprehend without fail in our feeble minds, but God is, God will be, forever and ever. I pray that we all have the strength to latch onto that and to lean on him as he has asked us to do in all of our times of tribulation. Lord, I pray for this church and each family member in here. I pray that we all have a wonderful week and that we can lean on each other in our times of need. In your heavenly name we pray. Amen.
All right. Is anybody else intrigued by this sermon title?
All right. Ooh, I have some time this morning. I thought I was going to have to fly through this. We have a lot to cover, so I am going to move fairly quickly, but I can take a couple breaths. Before we get into the meat of the sermon, we're going to be spending most of our time in Exodus chapter 3, but it might be a little helpful to lay some groundwork first. So we have to go back to Exodus chapter 2. And the story where we're picking up today is Moses after he has killed an Egyptian and then fled into Midian. And he finds a job and he finds a home with a man named Jethro. In Exodus 2, 21 and 22, it says, "Then Moses was content to live with the man, Jethro, and Jethro gave Zipporah, his daughter, to Moses, and she bore him a son. He called his name Gershom." And Gershom, it actually sounds very similar to the Hebrew word for foreigner. "He called his name Gershom, for he said, I have been a stranger in a foreign land." And so this little bit of background here, it is laying a foundation for Moses's identity, who Moses identified as at this point of time. And in just these two verses, we find out that Moses is a husband, Moses is a father, and Moses is a stranger or an exile. And so we can be clear here that Moses has left Israel and he's found a new life. He has started a new life. Yet even though Moses had left Egypt, time and history continue to march on for the rest of the Hebrew people. Now it happened in the process of time that the king of Egypt died. Then the children of Israel groaned because of the bondage, and they cried out, and their cry came up to God because of the bondage. So God heard their groaning. God what, everyone? I gotta wake y'all up today. So I'm gonna make this a little more interactive than I normally do. So God heard their groaning, and God remembered, God what, everyone? Remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And God looked. God what, everyone? Yes, God looked upon the children of Israel and God acknowledged them. I find comfort in these verses because what they tell us is that the pharaohs of life come and go, but God and his promises last forever. God's children, they cried out. And this is a recurring theme in the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. God's people crying out, God hearing them. But God's children cried out, and like any good parent, God heard, God remembered, God looked, God was concerned. This is the type of God that we serve. He listens. He remembers his promises. He looks after his creation, and he expresses concern over injustices. Yet with God, it isn't all just thoughts and prayer, right? God actually does something about it all. And that's where we move into chapter 3. So chapter 3, verse 1, "Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God." And so here we can add one more identity marker to Moses. One more. He's still a father, a husband, an exile, but now we see that he is also a shepherd. He's a leader. He's a provider. He is a protector of his flock. And he's going about his normal everyday business of making sure that his sheep find grass and water, food and drink. But then something interesting happens. "And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, And behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So what's interesting here is that if you take a wide lens look, and above a helicopter view of Moses' life, you'll see that it fits into three distinct periods, right? And each of those periods are 40 years. He spent 40 years in Egypt, then he spent 40 years out in Midian, and then his last 40 years was spent wandering in the wilderness. So at this point, though, this mid part, he's been a shepherd in Midian for about 40 years. And he would have been very familiar with the area. He would have been very familiar with all of the natural elements that made it up. And so he's going through the motions, you could say, his normal daily routine. But then something unusual catches his eye. It grabs his attention. And he sees a bush that has caught fire, which actually isn't too strange for him. Did you know that there are actually plants that can burst into flame? Did you know that? They do exist. This plant, Dictamus albus, which is native to warm habitats such as Southern Europe, Northern Africa, and much of Asia, is nicknamed simply burning bush. Burning bush. That is this plant's nickname. And it contains numerous volatile oils, one of which is isoprene. Isoprene. And so it can just burst into flames if it's in hot weather. And so this has led some scholars to believe that this right here could have been this bush that Moses encountered. So it's very possible that the initial sight of seeing a bush on fire, it was nothing amazing. It was nothing astounding or alarming. But then he stopped to look and he noticed the truly surprising thing, that the bush was on fire. Yes, he'd seen that before, but it wasn't being consumed. It wasn't being burned up. And that was something he'd never witnessed before. And this is where I want to get to the true meat of the sermon. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he said, we must be ready to allow ourselves to be interrupted by God. We must allow ourselves to be interrupted by God. So Moses lived out in the wilderness. He'd gone up Mount Horeb to search out a grassy area so that his sheep could feed. And this was just an ordinary day for him, full of seemingly mundane tasks, just the typical stuff. But then God interrupted him. And Moses had a choice. Moses had a choice in that moment to keep on walking or to stop and inspect the interesting sights. And as we've talked about, it wasn't too interesting to him. He had most likely seen bushes on fire before. But if he didn't pause and allow God's interruption, he might not have noticed the truly mysterious fact that the bush was not burning up in those flames. I believe that's how God works. He finds us where we are, often within the seemingly mundane. We can find ourselves wanting God to make big things happen, right? We're on the constant lookout for huge miracles, tremendous signs, and God can do those things, right? Of course, God can do those things. He has done those things, but God is very often present in the ordinary and the humdrum of day-to-day life. How often are we paying attention? How often are we actively looking for God in our day-to-day activities? And this is where I get kind of nervous. When I hear people constantly making these very strict black and white distinctions between what they term secular and holy. Have you ever heard this? Maybe you've done it. I know I've been guilty of this in the past. They make these distinctions, but what I believe that it does is it creates the unconscious notion that God might not be present in or able to use things that we do not deem as being holy. Do you see how that can be dangerous in a daily walk with God, where we are supposed to be continually being sanctified, connecting with him, having a relationship with him, hearing his voice, looking for his fingerprints every second of every day? In the Bible, it tells us that Jesus came to make all things new, and that all things are held together by him, and that for those of us who love God, he is able to make all things work together for good. Do not discount what God can do and where he is present. So something caught Moses' eye. And then look at this. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am. Here I am." So this bush is on fire. It's not burning up. And now God's voice is coming from the bush. We are now clearly within the realm of the supernatural, right? There's no denying that. God is planning something big here. But what would have happened if Moses had not turned aside? I mean, it's all conjecture. We don't know because he did. But what would have happened if he didn't? What if he hadn't stopped to take a closer look? So yes, God meets us in the seemingly mundane, but are we willing to listen, to look, and to turn aside from our focuses, our plans, our wants, our goals, our desires? This tells me that God is willing to meet us wherever we are, but often we have to slightly alter our course in order to meet him. Can anyone else read this picture? You know, we have our plan, and it's usually pretty straightforward. We have the end goal in sight. And then we look at God's plan. And when we're in that water, when we're in that ditch of rocks, whatever it is, when we're going up that treacherous path, when we're in the midst of those, we can often be like, "Where are you, God? What are you doing?" When really, if we're honest with each other, we're saying, "God, why is life not more easy?" When we're on our straight path, heading towards whatever goals we have, raising a family, furthering our career, going to school, et cetera, he usually doesn't just jump out in front of us and block our path. No, God is generally just adjacent to us, so that we have to show a willingness to slightly alter our course in order to meet with him. And that, dear friends, is where some really powerful stuff can happen. We can begin to have incredible, awe-inspiring encounters with a supernatural God within the confines of the ordinary and the seemingly mundane. So let me just give you a question to think about and reflect upon as you go through the rest of this day. What was an ordinary event in your life that God took and transformed into something extraordinary? Think about that. I want you to think about that. And I'm sure that if we all sat here for a few minutes and thought real hard, most everyone in here could have a story to tell. You're going about your normal, everyday life, but then God speaks and causes you to just slightly alter your course. And then the normal and the mundane turns into something noteworthy and miraculous. And this is what life in the Spirit can look like. So Moses says, here I am. And then God continues. Then God said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. This word here translated holy, it's the Hebrew word kadesh, kadesh. And it simply means different, set apart, or unusual. This ground was now different, set apart, or unusual because it's occupied at that moment by the Creator God, the one who is symbolized by the bush that is burning but not being consumed. Moreover, God said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Essentially, he's saying, I made a covenant. I remember that covenant. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people. He what, everyone? He saw. Oh yeah, I kind of tricked you there, right? He seen. God saw the oppression of his people that who are in Egypt. And he says, I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me. And I have also, once again, the second time he's saying, I have seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Now, I'm sure all of this was very, very encouraging to Moses. Hearing God say, I have surely seen the oppression. I know their sorrows. I have come down to deliver. I have seen the oppression. But then there's that last part. God says, and I am sending you. And Moses is thinking to himself, what? Send me? And remember, we've seen all the things that Moses is, right? He's a husband, he's a father, he's an exile, he's a shepherd. And Moses is still all of those things, but now God is calling him to something even more. I want you to take that little bit and just put it in your back pocket for later. I know you're picking up on the fact that like he's putting out a lot of threads and he's not tying them together. It's coming, it's coming. But hold that in your back pocket. It's not that Moses isn't all these things, but that God is calling him to something even more. So Moses hears that God is wanting to send him and he protests. Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? So God said, I will certainly be with you. And this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Now, if you know the story, you know that that did come true. But a lot of stuff had to happen before they got there. But now look at this. Moses is saying, who am I? And what God responds with, it isn't really an answer, is it? I mean, it is an answer, but it isn't. Who am I? And God says, I will certainly be with you. I'd imagine to Moses that this didn't feel like a good answer because he's clearly dealing with some sort of imposter's syndrome. Imposter syndrome is an internal experience of believing that you are not as competent as others perceive you to be. It involves feelings of self-doubt and personal incompetence that persist in spite of your education, your experience, and accomplishments. And this is an issue that is happening more and more nowadays. And you might be surprised, but it's usually the most accomplished and talented people that struggle with this the most. So Moses is thinking, I can't do this. This is too large of a task, God. Who am I, Lord? Send someone else. That's the gist of what Moses is getting at here. I love all that stuff you said, God. You saw, you heard, you're gonna do something about it, but send someone else. Yet God's response, I will be with you, is the same as Jesus' response in the Great Commission, right? The Great Commission, Matthew 28, 18 through 20. And Jesus came and spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And that's usually where we step in and we say, whoa, but who am I? Send someone else. That's what you mean, right, Jesus? And his response is, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So God commanded Moses to go and promise to be with him. Jesus commanded the disciples and us to go and promise to be with us. And it's the perfect promise to crush any doubts, any fears, any feelings of lack. If God says go, we can be assured that he is going with us. Then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And God said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. That's what you say. Wow. What a miraculous and powerful event this burning bush thing was. And it's easy for us to look back at Moses, to look back at his life and feel that he was always this powerful, enigmatic, profoundly inspired individual, that he was like some larger than life figure. But we must remember that when he was chosen, when he was called by God, he was just an ordinary person, right? He was a father, he was a husband, he was an exile, a stranger. He was a shepherd. He was just an ordinary person moving forward in the common walks of life. Yet God drew near, got his attention, and helped mold Moses into the mighty prophet that we think of today when we hear his name. Dear friends, do not discount the work that God desires to bring about through your life, through your influence, through your willingness to serve him. We may look at these mighty stories of biblical faith, or even the more modern examples like Mother Teresa, Billy Graham, Ellen White, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, fill in the blanks. People that seem to be like of this elevated status, right? They're closer to God, did a tremendous amount of good in the name of God. And we may look at them and feel very, very small, low stature, too common. I'm too simple. I'm too uneducated. I'm too flawed. I'm too basic. But we are important and special to God. That's the good news of the Bible. That is the message Christ came to bring, that God loves you so much that he became a man, drew near to you, died for you, and offers you free, unmerited,
unearned gift called salvation. The mighty power of God, the mighty call from his Spirit. These may seem so far above us, yet, and I believe this following truth with all of my heart. This comes from the book Desire of Ages, page 48. To us in the common walks of life, heaven may be very near. You like that? I love that. To us in the common walks of life, heaven may be very near. We feel like we are small, we're very far away from God. God doesn't feel that way. God desires a willing heart. God wants humble servants. God calls, then equips. It's easy for us to get caught up in our own lives, our own desires, our own plans. But God is constantly looking to interrupt us. And if we are willing to look for him, to listen for his leading, to alter our course, sometimes ever so slightly, we might find ourselves experiencing the noteworthy and the miraculous within the normal and mundane. For example, allow me to tell you a bit about baked potatoes, baptisms, and burned feet. Did y'all forget about the title of this sermon? The past month or so has been quite the adventure. There was the Called Pastors Convention in Kentucky, followed by a week of VBS here at church, then 11 straight days in Wauwoka for Oklahoma Conference camp meeting. And I'll be honest with y'all, though God did bless immensely, I'm exhausted. I'm tired. I know I'm fired up this morning, but I'm exhausted. And I'm looking forward to next week's little vacation. But last week, on the final Sabbath of camp meeting, God had some interruptions. We just finished our morning session with the primary children's division, which is about 50 kids aged 6 to 9 in a small room for over 3 hours. So I think you can start to maybe process what that was like. It was fun, but it was also wild and crazy at times. And once the children were back with their parents or guardians, I was ready to hopefully catch some rest before the evening's meetings when we had all the kids back again. And so my plan was to go back to the hotel where there was air conditioning, share a meal with my bride, Sarah, and maybe even get to take a short little nap on the comfortable bed. Those were my plans, but God had other plans. Nick Shepherd had prepared some lunch for his family, and so he extended an invitation to Sarah and I to eat with them up in the primary room. Now, I could have easily said no to this, right? I was exhausted and had my own plans already, but instead, I chose to just slightly alter my course. We accepted the invitation. We stayed for a meal of salad and barbecue and baked potatoes. We sat down and we began to eat when all of a sudden, Richard Bell, he was like right here beside me. He's like, hey, Pastor, I've been looking for you. He said that he'd been trying to track me down for some time. Now, if you weren't there last Sabbath, I'll just let you in on a fact that there were over 1,000 people there at that time. So not super easy to find someone you were looking for. But by God's grace, Richard found me and he said, I've been searching for you because we just found out that Abriano was wanting to get baptized up at the pool. And he asked me if I would be willing to do it. And I said, sure. What time is this at? And he told me the time, and I looked at my Fitbit, and the baptisms were going to be taking place at that pool in 15 minutes. I have a plate of food. I'm wearing, you know, jeans and a button up. And so I thought about it, and I'm like, okay. I knew that I'd be cutting it extremely close, but I figured I could rush back, speed back, Lord forgive me, get to the hotel, get in my swim trunks, get back, and just be a few minutes late, maybe 5 or 10 minutes late. And so I grabbed another paper plate, and as hard as it was, I covered mine and I gave it to my wife. And I was like, can you just keep this safe? I'll eat it later. And about that time, Luke Shepherd, who was also in the room, he spoke up and he said, hey, I have some swim trunks over at the lodge and they just might fit you. So I was like, okay, that is a much better plan than I had. Let's do that. And then Nick spoke up. He'd been driving the golf cart around that morning and afternoon, taking people to different locations. So he was like, Luke, I'll give you the keys. You can drive them over there. It'll be much quicker than if you had to walk. So he did that. And Norma and Rex, they also wanted to get over to the pool. So then by this point, we have a troop. It's Luke, Rex, Norma, Sarah, and I. We headed downstairs, got to the golf cart. We all piled in, and then he's turning the key, and it's just, it's not starting. And Chef Sam was right there, and so we're like, Chef Sam, come over here, because he can fix anything. And he tried, but he couldn't fix that golf cart and didn't know what was wrong with it. It had gas. But just about that time, Lewis then drove up. He's our new Oklahoma Conference evangelism coordinator. Lewis drove up in his own golf cart. And so I talked to Chef Sam the next day, and he still had no idea what happened to that golf cart. But thanks to Lewis being in the right place at the right time, unbeknownst to him, he was able to give us a ride over to the lodge. So we got over there, I got changed, and then I was walking across the road from the lodge to the pool. And boy, oh boy, was that black asphalt very hot on my bare feet. I mean, I was dancing across. But when it was all said and done, this happened. Abrianna was baptized. Amen. Along with 10 other people of varying genders, ages, and nationalities, a true taste of what it's gonna be like in heaven. Amen. The burned feet, they simply helped to sear this experience into the archives of my memories. And the other cool thing is that Abrianna wasn't even in my classes. She wasn't in my division. She was in the junior division with Pastor Nathan and Pastor Irwin. And so after the baptisms, I made my way back across to the lodge. And I swear the ground was hotter that time that it was the first one. And I was honestly scared that I was gonna have blisters. But God, in his infinite mercy, simply saved the soles of my feet from any lasting damage and instead set a fire in my spiritual soul. Amen. And looking back now, I can see all of these pieces that had to fall into place in order for that baptism to take place in the way that it did. God used Nick to interrupt my plans. And Sarah and I made the decision to turn aside and alter our course. God sent Richard to come find me, led him to the exact room where I was, and gave me the invitation to baptize his daughter. Luke saved me from rushing back to the hotel and offered me his swim trunks. Lewis showed up for a divine appointment, unbeknownst to him at the time. He found out later, I let him know. Pastors Nathan and Irwin created a safe space for Abrianna to learn about Jesus throughout the week and to choose to serve and follow him and make the decision to get baptized. Now, I've lived long enough and experienced enough of God's blessings and interruptions to know that I'm probably only scraping the surface here in my understanding of all the things God was doing behind the scenes to make this all happen. And I share this with you all today to encourage you that no matter what you are going through, no matter what you are facing, that if you cry out to God, he will hear your prayers. He will remember his promises. He will look upon you with favor, and he is concerned with your best interest. He sees oppression. He knows our sorrows, and he will and already has come down to deliver us. And maybe, just maybe, he is planning to use you in order to help someone else in their time of need. Maybe he is planning to send you to represent him. So the questions we must ask ourselves this morning Are we willing to allow God to interrupt our plans, our desires, our ways? Are we willing to seek God and listen for his voice at all times, even during those moments that are seemingly mundane, boring, and ordinary? Thank you, Ron. And if he does decide to send us forth in his name, will we go forth believing and trusting that he will go with us? I don't know exactly how God is planning to use you or send you, but we should all take comfort in the fact that God is on our side. It doesn't matter what qualifiers make up your identity, whether you're a parent or a spouse or a brother or a sister, a plumber or a doctor, whether you're old or young, whether you're a student or a teacher, whether you are well-known or you're a bit of an outcast. You can be all of those things. But God is calling you to something even more. The devil may come after us. Our enemies may try and slow us down. Obstacles may block our path. But the truth is this, dear friends, and this is my last slide. What then shall we say to these things, the devil coming after us, enemies in our way, obstacles blocking? If God is for us, who can be against us? To us, even in the common walks of life, heaven may be very near. Whether it's in the midst of baked potatoes, baptisms, or burned feet. Before we have our closing prayer, I want to invite Brandon to come forward. He's our elder in charge for today. And after the benediction, those of you who wish to be dismissed can be dismissed. But if there's anybody here that has any special burdens, special requests, special needs, special praises, and you would like to come talk with either Brandon or myself, we would love to hear from you. We'd love to pray with you and lift your request, your petition, your praise up to God. Let us pray. Our loving, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, it might catch us off guard. It might frustrate us in the moment. But Lord, right now in this moment, we just want to thank you for your interruptions. And we want to ask, we want to plead with you that you would speak to us in those moments, that you would give us a willingness, a desire to sometimes just slightly alter our path so that we can meet with you. Lord, take those moments that to us feel very normal, mundane, and make them into something noteworthy and miraculous because you are there. Lord, maybe you are calling us to represent you. Lord, if you are, it's okay if we ask the question and we wonder, why me, Lord? Who am I? Send someone else. But may our next thought be the reminder that when you told Moses to go, when Jesus told us to go, it was qualified with the promise that you would be with us. So Lord, send us forth. Go before us. Stay beside us. And fill us with your spirit. Give us opportunities to find you, to hear you, whatever we're doing, wherever we are. Lord, may we believe that even in our common walks of life, that heaven is very near. We ask this all in the name of Jesus, and we believe there is power in this prayer because we ask it in his name. Amen and amen.
We here at the Edmond Seventh-day Adventist Church want to offer a safe and engaging place for you to come to know Jesus. Our mission is to know Jesus, to reflect his character, and share his message. Now, while the church building is open once again, we realize that many of you, for varying circumstances, whether it's the pandemic, whether it's distance, you can't be here in person, but we still want to connect with you. So please, like us on Facebook, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and check out our website, edmundadventist.org. We look forward to connecting with you and walking alongside you as you come to know Jesus better. Thank you.